Hello, my name is Andrew Burns, and I'm chief of the Gene Transfer and Immunogenicity Branch in the Division of Cellular and Gene Therapies. The goal of this presentation is to explain the basics of how to put together the CMC section of a gene therapy IND, particularly for phase one trials. Human gene therapy INDs are submitted to the Office of Cellular, Tissue, and Gene Therapies, and the CMC information is then evaluated by reviewers in the Division of Cellular and Gene Therapies. So what are gene therapy products? Gene therapies are quite different than traditional small molecule drugs or even other biologics. They work by delivering genetic material, or less commonly, they work by modifying the sequence of the human genome. Gene therapy products consist of genetically modified nucleic acids, viruses, or microorganisms, and gene therapies often mediate their effects by transferring genetic material. When this genetic material is transcribed or translated inside a cell, the result is new RNA or protein. Products are also considered gene therapies when they directly modify the human genome, either by integrating into it or by modifying genome sequences. How are gene therapy products used? Often gene therapy vectors are administered directly to patients, and the vectors in turn modify cells inside the patients. But another common strategy is to take human cells and modify them using gene therapy in vitro, and then the modified cells can be administered to patients. We also have a webinar available on cell-based therapies if you'd like further information about how to prepare INDs for cellular products. Here are a few examples of gene therapy products. In the first two examples, a plasmid or an adeno-associated virus has been modified to express a foreign gene such as an enzyme or a coagulation factor. These types of gene therapy vectors are often administered directly to patients. In contrast, the third example is of cells modified in vitro using a gene therapy vector. T cells can be removed from a patient, transduced with a retroviral vector that expresses a novel T cell receptor, and then transferred back into patients. In the fourth example, in some cases, non-human cells such as bacteria can be genetically modified and then administered to patients to attempt to treat a disease. In the example shown here, bacteria can be engineered to act as a vaccine that stimulates the immune system to attack tumors. Finally, replication-competent viruses may be used as biologics that replicate in and kill tumor cells. If the virus expresses a foreign gene, it's considered a gene therapy. If it doesn't express a foreign gene, it's not a gene therapy, but it's still regulated by the Office of Cellular, Tissue, and Gene Therapies. The purpose of this next slide is to illustrate how the manufacturing process for a gene therapy product may be very complex, and also to make the point that the FDA needs to have information on all of the steps in your manufacturing process in order to fully evaluate the safety and quality of the final product. We'll also be coming back in more detail to some of these important points on subsequent slides. In the example shown here, the final product on the right side of the screen is retrovirally transduced CD34 positive cells. On the left side of the screen, you can see that the starting material was mononuclear cells from donated peripheral blood. So you need to provide information on how the donor was screened. Next, CD34 positive cells were then selected with a device that uses a monoclonal antibody against CD34. For this step, include information on the selection device and describe how the monoclonal antibody was produced and tested to ensure that it is free of adventitious viruses. Regardless of whether you submit this information in the form of a certificate of analysis or a letter of cross-reference, please make sure that you are providing the FDA with all of the information that we need to review. Returning to the manufacturing process, after selection, the CD34 positive cells were transduced with the retroviral vector. You will need to provide information on the constructs, cells, and processes that were used to manufacture the retrovirus. In addition, the diagram shows that the transduction process includes not only a retrovirus, but also fibronectin and growth factors. Even if these other proteins are produced by another company, it is your responsibility to ensure that we have information on how these materials were manufactured and tested. The manufacturing of recombinant growth factors and cytokines often includes an affinity purification step, which may use monoclonal antibodies. If this is the case, you would need to include information on those monoclonal antibodies as well. Finally, include in your IND a lot release form showing the release criteria for the final product, which in this case is the transduced CD34 positive cells. I'd like to draw your attention to the following guidance that the FDA published in 2008, entitled Guidance for FDA Reviewers and Sponsors, content and review of CMC information for human gene therapy INDs. This guidance covers these topics in a much more comprehensive manner than I'll have time to do in the current presentation. In addition, if your final product contains human cells, there is also a 2008 guidance on human somatic cell therapy that you'll find helpful. Now let's look at the various aspects of the CMC section of an IND in more detail, following this outline. First, I'll describe what information you need to include on the raw materials and other components that you'll use to manufacture your gene therapy product. Next, we'll discuss the types of testing and characterization that should be performed on your final product. Finally, we'll examine the GMP practices that you'll follow during manufacturing of a gene therapy product for a phase 1 trial. So let's consider the various components that are used in manufacturing a gene therapy product. You'll need to tabulate and include information on all of the raw materials that you use to manufacture your product. This includes the vector, cells used for manufacturing your vector or as part of your final product, cell and viral banking systems, and all other reagents used in manufacturing. Additional information may be needed if any of your reagents are recombinant or from animals. Let's look at these areas one by one on the next few slides. For your vector, you will need to submit information on the history of the vector and details on the derivation of the vector construct. Please submit a vector diagram outlining the essential elements of the vector. In addition, you should submit a full sequence analysis for gene therapy vectors that are less than 40 kilobases in size. And this sequencing should occur before you start your clinical trial. For larger vectors, we encourage full sequencing prior to phase 3. But for phase 1 trials with a vector that is greater than 40 kilobases, we would expect sequencing of any modified reagents and flanking areas next to those regions. In the past, sponsors have found a number of surprises in the sequences of gene therapy vectors that would never have been caught otherwise. These unexpected findings include vectors where the therapeutic gene was in the reverse orientation, point mutations, unstable stretches of nucleotides, and even misidentified vectors. When you submit your sequence, it should be annotated. Please don't just include a printout of the nucleotides. If there are any unexpected sequences or open reading frames, you should summarize them and describe what these differences mean and how they might affect the behavior of your vector. For cell substrates used in the production of gene therapy vectors, the requirements are similar as for cells that are used in manufacturing other biologics such as vaccines and recombinant proteins. We need to know about the history, source, and general characteristics of your cell substrate. If your final product that will be administered to a patient is a human cell, we would need information about the source of the cells, the collection procedures, and compliance with donor eligibility requirements. If the cells are autologous, then donor eligibility screening is not required. Cells and vectors should be banked to minimize changes over time and to enhance the safety and consistency of your product. A number of safety tests need to be performed on your master cell bank and master virus bank. These include sterility, mycoplasma, and the two general virus screens for in vitro and in vivo adventitious viruses. Some of these assays can be difficult if your product is a replication-competent virus. If you find that your product interferes with any of these assays, please talk to us about how to proceed. If you use bovine serum and porcine trypsin, you'll need to test for bovine and porcine viruses unless you can clearly document that all of the serum and trypsin that you used was tested. Bovine reagents should also be documented to be from sources that are free of BSE. For human cell lines and human-derived viral vectors, we ask for a standard panel of virus-specific PCR tests, including tests for EBV, HBV and HCV, CMV, HIV, HTLV, and B19. If your cell line is derived from mice or some other species, you will need to test for species-appropriate viruses. Finally, for gene therapy products that are designed to be replication incompetent, there might be a risk of recombination events occurring during manufacturing that will generate a replication-competent virus. So we may ask you to test for replication-competent virus. In addition to safety testing on your master cell bank, there is a certain minimal amount of characterization that should be done for phase 1. This includes showing that the cells are what they are supposed to be. And there are a variety of methods to do this identity testing, such as measuring isoenzymes, karyotyping, and STR profiling. You should also show that the cells are viable and put your master cell bank on a stability testing program. For characterization of the master virus bank, we've already discussed sequencing requirements. In addition, you should also perform assays to determine the activity and the titer of the vector. It's also a good idea to have some ongoing stability assessment of your master virus bank. In your IND, you should tabulate all of the reagents that you use to manufacture your product, including the source and grade of each. We often see research-grade reagents being used to manufacture cell and gene therapies. There's no general problem with this, but you'll need to document that all appropriate testing and characterization have been performed on these reagents. If the reagent is a protein or other material derived from humans, animals, or bacteria, there may be additional tests required. This is especially true for things like recombinant cytokines and growth factors. Quite often, these are purified using affinity chromatography on monoclonal antibody columns. And this introduces a possible risk of contamination with mouse viruses. So appropriate testing for such viruses would be needed. It's very helpful to provide certificates of analysis for reagents in your IND, although these may not always contain enough information. If there's a regulatory master file available for any of the reagents that you use, please supply a letter of cross-reference from the manufacturer and indicate exactly what information is being cross-referenced. Finally, as part of good manufacturing practices, you should have a qualification program in place to assess the quality of the reagents used in your manufacturing process. You should provide a complete and detailed description of all steps in manufacturing your product. For a viral vector, this would include cell growth, infection, viral harvest, and additional steps such as purification, formulation, filing, and storage. It's very helpful to provide a flowchart in addition to the written description. For the final formulation, all components in your formulation need to be completely described. Final product testing for complex biologics, such as cell and gene therapies, can be quite a challenge. You don't always have a well-defined active ingredient, and there may be a lot of variability in the manufacturing process. Your goals should be to produce a safe and consistent product that is characterized to an appropriate extent. In your IND, you should provide a listing of release test methods and acceptance criteria for the final product. You can provide a sample final product COA, or even the actual COA if you have it at the time that you submit your IND. Critical safety-related tests should always have firm acceptance criteria. But for a few characterization assays, you may not have a lot of experience with them, and you'll simply report those results on your COA without predefined acceptance criteria. We expect that you'll eventually set appropriate limits for all tests as you gain more experience manufacturing your product. Safety tests are common to all biologics. The basic requirements for safety testing include sterility, mycoplasma, and endotoxin testing, and the requirements for these are described in 21 CFR 610. For INDs, we allow non-compendial tests also, but these require additional description and justification to ensure that the tests are as sensitive and as appropriate as the compendial tests. In addition to tests for sterility, mycoplasma, and endotoxin, for products like gene therapy vectors that are manufactured on human or animal cells, we ask for in vitro adventitious virus testing. It may also be appropriate to test for replication-competent revertants or recombinants as well, depending on what kind of vector you are using. Final product characterization is often a challenge when your product is a complex biologic, and you'll probably have to develop a number of unique assays that are specific for your product's concentration, purity, identity, activity, potency, or viability. The emphasis for products at phase one is mainly to provide enough information to evaluate safety, so not all of the assays shown here may need to be performed at phase one. The critical assays will depend on the nature of your product, and it's a good idea to discuss your lot release criteria with the FDA during a pre-IND meeting. Our approach to product characterization is that as the clinical trial progresses, the sponsor should continue to refine acceptance criteria and to develop additional test methods to better characterize the product. Stability of your product is also very important, even at phase one, and you should have a stability testing program that periodically examines the dose and activity of your product. Also, if you plan to use a delivery device such as catheter to administer your product, you should submit data in your IND showing that the device does not inactivate your product. It's to your advantage to characterize your product beyond the bare minimum, even for phase one trials. This will help to ensure that you are manufacturing a consistent product. It may be difficult or impossible to determine whether a very variable product is safe and effective in clinical trials. Another reason is that manufacturing changes are inevitable, and you will need to demonstrate comparability of products before and after manufacturing changes. For example, if you need a cytokine to manufacture your product and it becomes unavailable, you'll have to switch to another supplier. You'll need to be confident that you can manufacture the same product even after the switch in reagents. Please refer to the Advanced Topics webinar for a more in-depth presentation on these issues. Now let's turn to GMPs. There is sometimes confusion about what GMPs really are and the relationship between product characterization and GMPs. The focus should be on using scientifically sound methods and keeping appropriate records with the end goal of producing a quality product. Some manufacturers think that GMPs are just having a number of SOPs in place, writing everything down, and having an independent group sign off on the certificate of analysis. But GMPs are also about controlling your manufacturing process. And if you can't accurately measure the purity and potency of your product, it will be difficult to ensure that the manufacturing process produces a consistent product. Because gene therapy products and other complex biologics can be difficult to fully characterize at phase one, we expect that manufacturers will increase their control of the manufacturing process over time in parallel with clinical development. There are more details in the 2008 Guidance for Industry, CGMP for Phase 1 Investigational Drugs. Your quality control program is a critical aspect of GMP that we look at carefully when reviewing your IND because it has a direct bearing on the safety of your product. Your QC group can be as small as one person, but ideally they should be independent and empowered to accept or reject each lot of your product based on whether or not the lot meets predefined acceptance criteria. Your quality control group should be proactive, and they'll help you to learn from manufacturing failures and also to continuously improve your manufacturing processes and testing methods. The responsibilities of your QC group should be written in a formal QC plan. So here are some general GMP-related questions that you should be asking yourself even at the very earliest stages. Is your manufacturing process reproducible? Do you have appropriate testing at critical steps? Do you have adequate control over the quality of your reagents? Is your record keeping adequate? Although it certainly requires a large initial investment to put GMPs in place, experienced manufacturers are very aware of the ultimate benefits, which include time and money saved, and most importantly, improved product safety. In addition to being required by the FDA, GMPs are just good common sense, and you'll reap dividends in the long run. Here are some specific examples of GMPs that should be incorporated into your manufacturing program, even at the earliest stages. Because many manufacturing facilities make more than one product, it's critical to have controls in place to prevent cross-contamination and mix-ups among products. These include procedures for aseptic processing, cleaning and changeover between manufacturing campaigns, and tracking and segregation of products. In some cases where equipment is reused to make multiple products, you may even want to specifically test to ensure that your product has not been contaminated by prior products. In our experience, mix-ups and contaminations do happen from time to time, and it can be potentially unsafe for patients and very expensive and troublesome for you to resolve. As another example of GMPs to pay attention to at an early stage, it is usually important to have some basic information available on specificity and reproducibility of characterization assays. A bad assay can lull you into a false sense of security. Finally, it's important, even at phase one, to qualify any critical manufacturing processes that have a direct impact on the safety of the final product. For example, removing any impurities that might be unsafe. So, to summarize the FDA's approach to evaluating the CMC section of early phase gene therapy INDs, we focus on product safety first and foremost. We're interested in both universal safety assays such as sterility, as well as more unique characterization assays that you may need to develop differently for each product. Also, as I have just discussed, we expect you to follow GMPs that are appropriate for your stage of product development. As you gain more experience with your product and you progress to larger clinical trials, you'll develop more advanced and refined methods that will contribute to both the safety and quality of your product. This concludes my presentation. Thank you for your attention. Further detailed information can be found in CBER's many guidance documents, and I invite you to review the other presentations in this series to learn about other aspects of INDs for cell and gene therapy products.